My favorite thing I like to do is to nibble. Right here is one of the greatest peppers ever. It's the best. That's a good nibble, just raw kale. It's good for the system.
Nasturtium flowers.
Look how beautiful this is. This is the ultimate nibble.
Mm. Look at this little thing.
This is a cocoa bean. This isn't good. Now we're gonna have a cocoa bean plant grow there next year.
So we're just making our deliveries right now. We're in Toronto. We work with a lot of small restaurants that have pretty short menus that flip pretty consistently. They're all kind of based off seasonal food and local food, which is great, and that works really well for us. First stop is gonna be at Actinolite. We're gonna meet Justin, an incredible chef and a real honor to work with. He's really into the idea of the product shining through. So he's helping us get our message across by keeping the ingredients honest. They're cooking everything outside, kind of based around the fireplace. It kind of seems like you're at like a small cottage gathering. Probably one of the more exciting places in the city right now, in my opinion.
Probably the last of the tomatoes for us.
At this quantity probably and this quality.
And what about the zucchini?
They're coming slow right now. They're definitely tapering off, but for what you need, I can probably do another week or two.
And mustards?
Japanese, green wave, red frills, Osaka mustards.
I always ask all the farmers, what are you cooking right now?
Right.
You know, especially you being a chef, even if you're cooking at home, it's like it gives inspiration and I love that. All the leftover of these tomatoes, we're oven drying them with a vinaigrette, fermented bean, soya, and serve it with oysters, like on the sides.
I like that.
Squash too, do you have squash coming?
Winter squash, yeah. Koginai and black futsu.
And you're just ripening it now?
They're curing now, yeah. And I'll just be slowly bringing them out.
Because that's something in the next little bit, I'm curious about. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Amazing, man, we love our farmers.
Thank you, Jeff.
Hello everybody, we're here at Blue Goose again with Lee Valley. Today's gonna be our third and final video here at Blue Goose.
Second week of September right now, all the beds are in their last planting. We've got a few really cool things that we wanna show you guys, so come take a look.
Take a look.
So we're here in front of some of our winter squash that we're slowly pulling out of a patch that we had planted up here in the Little Goose. Here we have a variety called Koginut, and this is a black futsu. So right now these are just kind of curing, same way that we cure onions and the shallots like we did in the last video with you guys. Be out in the sun to bake the skins, helps them develop flavor and some sweetness, and they'll store far better for the winter.
When you cut these, there's a lot of beautiful sweet juice in the stems, and the bees come out.
Yeah.
I really love that.
We cut them the other day and then we put them out on the table and there was just a swarm of bees all over them. So we didn't really work in the Little Goose for much of the day. The bees were kind of...
The bees will get you.
Yeah, the bees were doing
their
thing.
They'll zap you.
There's still quite a few up here, but they've kind of chilled out. This is another success. We're gonna do a lot more winter squash next year down in the Big Goose.
It's just beautiful. You can roast it whole, cut it open, a little bit of salt and some warm butter on it, and it's just like the most perfect, beautiful vegetable. Like, what is the best kind of method for storing this at home?
Same kind of as a potato, I would say, like cool-ish and dry. I wouldn't put it anywhere damp. Kind of keep it out of direct sunlight if you can. This can be something that can get you through that hunger gap. You're waiting on the first spring harvest. You know, these squash keep really long, so you can always have stuff from your garden in your kitchen. So now we're standing in six rows of bunching greens here. In September, stuff like this really comes into its prime. Glazed collard greens, some black lacinato kale, and ruby Swiss chard as well. And they're all doing really good. It's a lot of food right here.
You can just come out here, grab a couple leaves of each, a quick saute or a steam.
Yeah, especially as it gets colder too. Well, these can take some pretty hard frosts. We're still in Canada, so they won't last all year long. Late December, you can come out here and be picking a green vegetable and bringing it inside. And we pick about 40 to 50 pounds a week out of these six beds. Lots more that we could pick, and they just regrow every single week.
And you could have a small bed, and you could have Swiss chard, you could have collards, you could have kale, and literally all season replenishing itself. It's just growing and cutting and growing and cutting. And then when you get through the whole summer, they just get sweeter and more juicy. And yeah. It's just one of those things that just keeps working and keeps growing. And it's so bountiful. So we got some radicchio here, we got some parsnips here, and we got some tomatoes with some blight over there that Kina doesn't really want to talk about too much, but it happens, it's okay. We have to normalize blight, okay? The parsnips is definitely the first time that we've done parsnips,
yeah.
Which is gonna be one of those big, big rewards when we pull those out of the ground. I doubt we're even gonna sell them. The great stuff, the first time stuff, is like stuff for us, and the stuff, we're just trying to like figure stuff out too. So maybe a couple lucky people will be able to get some of the parsnips. Snips,
yeah, we'll share some of them for sure. This bed has not been flipped. These need a full season to grow. We're gonna let the frost come in and kill back all the green growth completely. And we're probably gonna let the frost hit them 3 to 4 times probably. And then we're gonna get in here with a fork and dig them up. And that frost is gonna really concentrate the sugars. I'm really excited about this. They look a lot better than I was anticipating. So I love parsnips.
Parsnips, robust vegetables.
Yes.
This is when you're gonna see Keenan be sad.
I'm not too sad. We got early blight in July, which is really early. We've just been kind of managing it throughout the season. Once it's in, you can't get rid of it. It's a fungal disease. You can just try and do your best to take care of it. Now it's September. This is usually kind of the knockout punch for tomatoes. The blight gets them. That's why they look so sad. But the fruit is completely fine to eat. Still really good tomatoes. There's a nice yellow Brandywine over there, some green zebras still. Not like it was mid-August.
One of the most exciting things that we're growing here at Blue Goose is red Merlot Napa cabbage. You know, you can make sauerkraut out of it, you can saute it, you could grill it, you could braise it.
When it cooks or when you pickle it, it keeps its color really well. Sometimes yeah. Purple vegetables, like they kind of turn a little matted and brown, whereas this still stays like super bright.
Or purple potatoes, which are the worst vegetable of all time.
Yeah.
We both agree. We love all vegetables. All vegetables are great, but you need to calm down with the purple potato. Nobody needs the purple potato. It's not tasty. It's not nice in texture. This is a great example of something that retains its color when cooking.
And then next to this, we have some leeks, which we're also growing in the Big Goose, but this is an experiment with spacing. Down in the Big Goose, these are spaced 3 rows per bed, where this is 4. So we're gonna try and compare the weights and the sizes. You know, if this works out and it's comparable, then we're gonna probably implement a 4 spacing next year.
Get the hummingbird and the nasturtium.
Oh yeah,
we can get that shot. Oh, and it's gone. See, Blue Goose, you have to be so ready for anything. There's bees, there's hummingbirds. You know, Keenan says something incredibly intelligent. I say something incredibly stupid. It's Andy, no, we can't, this is not just a dash. We're not yelling at anybody today. My favorite thing I like to do is to nibble. And I'm gonna show you my favorite little nibble patch. So come with me. So this is our hot bananas.
Habanada.
What?
Habanada.
Habanada, yeah, I said that. Right here is one of the greatest peppers ever. It's like a fruity, peachy scotch bonnet, but there's zero heat. You know when you bite into a peach and you drown? The same kind of thing can happen from eating a habanana. It's the best. We got kale that like little butterflies got into. That's a good nibble, just raw kale. Good for the system. Nasturtium flowers. Look how beautiful this is. This is the ultimate nibble. You can make little oils out of this, garnishes. Vibrant floral, lemon, the nasturtium leaf. Incredible flavor, nibble. Everything is edible. These are so good. Wow. Ooh. Look at this little thing. We had a little bean in there. This is a cocoa bean. No. This isn't good. But like a couple weeks earlier, this would have just been like a beautiful green little unctuous pea that you could grab, a little bean you could grab and once again nibble on. This is a place that you live and learn.
Back in the Big Goose plot, everything here is in its final planting right now. This is our celeriac. Behind me, we have leeks and kale and some fall lettuces, as well as some green onions. The celeriac is something we're really excited about. I had absolutely zero success last year, and now we have about 100 feet of it growing. We've had a lot of water in the first couple weeks of September, and that's really helping the bulbs get bigger and swell. And they put out these really intense root systems. It takes quite a bit of effort to pull them up. I ate one the other day and it was just shaved raw and it tasted like celery and Parmesan almost. It was pretty wild.
There's so many different things that you can do, like Keenan said, like shaving it raw and slicing it, making a remoulade, you know, roasting it whole. I know that I used to make a broth back in the day at one of the restaurants at Parts and Labor where we would take celeriac, roast it for like 12 hours really slowly, and it would caramelize the whole inside of the celeriac with the skin on. And then we would peel back the roasted skin and we would make a tea.
Big success here, we're really happy. We're gonna eat a lot of it fresh and sell a lot of it fresh, but this holds up really well in storage. It's not the most economical thing to grow, but you know, it's one of those real humble kind of staple ingredients that Maddie and I really love, and the chefs that we work with really like stuff like this. Plus, it's gonna last us into the year. Yeah, Blue Goose is gonna be going all winter long, it seems, so it's really exciting. We're harvesting Caraflex cabbage right now. This is the second succession, and this is their proper time of growth. The leaves are way more healthy, bulbing out and bulking out way bigger than they did the first round. And you also have way more of a window at this time when it's not super hot. You can kind of harvest what you need without the fear of them getting too big or going to flower or bolting or pest pressure or anything. But we're probably taking about 30 a week into the city right now, which is quite a bit because they're quite large. So all I'd have to do is snap back a few of these outer leaves just to kind of expose the stalk where I'm gonna cut it. Then get my knife in there. These are really tender. It doesn't really take much to get your knife into them. They're ready to come out. Pull off some of these bottom bits of the stalk. And then we have a nice Caraflex cabbage. These are really, really good fresh. Nice big open texture. Great shape as well. They're super sweet and juicy. And the chefs we work with really love them. So yeah, these are our Caraflex cabbages. So one thing we've been doing a lot this year is kind of letting vegetables max out to their full potential in terms of size. I know what a lot of people think is like being the best or the most flavorful are like baby vegetables, like baby fennel. And you know, you can harvest this probably when it was about half the size and it is gonna be really juicy and very, very sweet, but you don't really get that kind of delicate, complex flavor that only we can have by growing in our soil and in our area. And so we're trying to get as much of our own personal terroir, I guess you could say, into the vegetables as we can. That way you're tasting the full potential of the vegetable and also what our soil is able to do for them. So that's been a thing that a lot of the chefs have really appreciated too. What we're gonna do with all the beds after the fall harvest is done, is we're just gonna top dress them with about an inch or two of compost, and then our tarp is gonna go on top. And that compost is just gonna help feed the earthworms over the winter time. It's gonna be a nice way to put it to sleep. And then when we pull the tarp off in the early spring, the beds are gonna be stale with no weed growth, hopefully, but they'll have already been amended so we can start planting right away.
So this brings us to the end of Blue Goose in Lee Valley. And here we are, just figuring it out and growing every year as people and as growers.
Yeah, it's been a really incredible year. We're gonna take a look at our notes at the end of the season, revise and revisit, take stock in the wins and losses, and really gonna refine this whole plot for next year and still keep up with the experimentation and, you know, try and keep you guys as posted and as informed as we possibly can.
From first year to this year, learning what kind of vegetables work, what kind of vegetables don't work. And next year, I think we're gonna be putting in like a proper greenhouse, adding a polytunnel. Every single year we're adding, literally being humbled, that's for sure.
Yeah, big time.
We really appreciate you guys, everybody watching, hanging out. If you wanna see more of these videos, tell Lee Valley. They're welcome to work with us anytime.
Anytime.
You know, grab a chisel. Anything Lee Valley makes is quality. Thanks for even coming around and checking us out, because we wouldn't have really done this probably without Lee Valley, that's for sure. More Blue Goose, I'm Maddie!
I'm Keenan.
Have a great day! Oh! Yeah!